Good evening and happy Sabbath, Covenant Advent Church.
Good evening and happy Sabbath.
And good evening and happy Sabbath to those of you who joined us online. I'll ask that you take up your hymnals and turn to hymn number 100. Hymn number 100, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Hymn number 100. Do we all have it? Okay, hymn number 100.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to what was supposed to be a Bible study, but was kind of dealing with a few different things here, so end up starting a little bit later than planned. So what I've been doing is a devotional thought with you, and I was just looking for a certain song, but I didn't find it. So we'll be doing a devotional thought, and then from there, I want to just share some thoughts from this morning presentation. So we'll just pray to begin.
Our Father, who art in heaven, we thank thee again for the blessings of this day, for the blessings, dear Lord, of your word, the fellowship, and a prayer, Lord, that you may, your guide in all things that we do, may you bless us by thy Spirit as we think on these things for Christ's sake. Amen.
So just wanted to share some thoughts this evening on this from this morning. There was a few things that I could have touched on, but didn't get a touch on. And so because of that, I decided to we just go ahead because we have about 30 minutes here.
So just share some thoughts. So I wanted to start back again from where I left off, because when you do it, like I do a study like that, there's often studies I do that I know they're because they're so current event that I could do as a series. But sometimes I want to communicate the thought and close off the thought. And you know, sometimes you have people attention for an hour or so. So if you think about this morning again, I started off with Romans chapter 3, verse 21. And in Romans chapter 3, verse 21, it says, being witnessed by the law and the prophet. That was the main thought that I had there, being witnessed. That there was something being witnessed by a law and prophet. And the law and the prophet witnessed some things, but all the law and prophets witness some things, it's not fulfilled. But I want to think about it, so interesting it is that in their time, there were people who lived a righteous life, right? But many people missed it. They couldn't understand what the symbols and all these things is. But the righteous always understood that these things point to something else. It was a training. In order for you to learn, you have to go through the basics. If you don't start with the basics, it's hard for you to understand the more advanced things. And remember, the Bible teaches us that the law is a schoolmaster, right? Paul says the law is a schoolmaster, but the intent for the schoolmaster is for you to grow, learn, and graduate. And when you graduate now, are you able to teach the subject? Right, but how will you teach the subject? You'd have to teach it like the way the schoolmaster would teach the subject, or the schoolmaster would operate the system. So when you think about it, right, the law and the law and the prophets witness of something. It's like somebody witnessing, and then one day you get the real thing. You know, somebody telling you a story, and they tell you something that this is possible, that is possible. When Jesus comes, you're like, oh, it's really possible. And I'm sure you've had that experience where you see something and you're like, it's really possible. But oftentimes we were brought up into churches that we hear about righteousness, but we often deceit, right? So, but it's being witnessed of, like people say, what you need is Jesus, right? What we need to hear is more about Jesus. But they never give you more about Jesus. They just keep telling you, this is what you need. So sometimes you get the witness, but it's not that the witness is bad, the witness is just what the witness is. Like again, the schoolmaster is taking you through a process. And many times we had to go through that process before we come to maturity, in other words. Because if I was a schoolmaster, I wouldn't try to start off a child that is 6 at the level of a child that is 12. Because it wouldn't work. There's a certain process to things. So why is that important? Because there's a few things I'm going to say, hopefully, before we end here, close the Sabbath. As we do church, we have to contemplate some things in a more mechanical way because we are more mature. So if you start off a person, what would you want to teach them first? How would you want to take them through that process? What would be the rudimentary things you teach them first? How would you start off teaching a person? That's actually a question I'm asking. What is important to teach first? Will you teach doctrines? Will you teach them prophecy? Will you teach them righteousness? What do you teach first? And just sit a little bit more back to Marcel, because Craigton has things he wants to say too, so. No, you go first tomorrow, but I'm just want to give him an opportunity. I don't want
This might be simplistic, but I was thinking basic Christianity.
All right, so basic Christianity.
And by that I mean to be kind to others, don't be a gossiper, don't be a warmonger.
So that's good. So basic Christianity, why? Why would you not? Go sit, make sure you stay back there so you can. I know you have more because I want you to answer the question.
But the smart kids sit in the front.
Yeah, okay. So basic Christianity. Tomorrow, I still want you to answer then. You should throw it out there. Why? Why would you want to teach basic Christianity first? Why some, not something else? Why basic Christianity? As though you know a schoolmaster, by God's grace. You're no longer but the student being handled by a schoolmaster. What would be your process?
I just think that if someone can learn to master basic Christianity, then the doctrines and everything else, they'll understand, but it makes more sense to them and it's more real in their life. Because, for instance, you could have someone who knows the doctrine of the second coming, let's say, mm-hmm. and they preach with all fervency Jesus is coming again. But it's not as real to someone who each day lives their life with basic Christianity, where because they know Jesus Christ is coming soon, they're trying to be kind to others and to live right and do right things because they want to be found without spot or wrinkle when he comes.
All right. So let me ask you this, I'm going to throw this out there. But could a person be disadvantaged if they didn't learn doctrines or the Ten Commandments first? Could basic Christianity affect them in a way that they still don't understand basic Christianity because they understand laws? I don't know if you need to answer that, but go ahead. If you need to answer, you can go ahead. I don't know.
Well, basic Christianity is wrapped up in the law. Basic Christianity is thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not bear false witness.
Okay.
Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house.
So you would teach basic Christianity with the law also. Yes. That's part of basic Christianity. Because, you know, some people say basic Christianity is the gospel. We just need to hear the gospel only. That's like what we're talking about this morning. I just need the gospel only. I don't need nothing else. But I think Craig and
Brother. Just like what Sister Tamara was saying, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's house, thy neighbor's wife.
That's basic
Christianity.
Right, okay, see, you know, as a schoolmaster, your school is set up different from most schoolmasters. Because you think about most of what we're talking about in Orthodoxy or contemporary Christianity, they set up their school because the church is supposed to be a school that basic Christianity is just Christ on the cross. We don't know explanation as to what was the argument he was levying. What was it? Did he lift up the law of God? Did he, you know, make the rules important, but also teach that judgment and grace and mercy is important? So, what is basic Christianity? You know, would be a big question. What if you say, okay, I'm gonna teach basic Christianity? What is basic Christianity? Because everybody said basic Christianity is just Christ dying on the cross for my sin. Go ahead, please.
Oh, no, that's okay. I'm still on the original question, how would you teach?
Yeah, if you're a schoolmaster, how would you teach? What would be the first things you teach your students?
Well, you know, we learn in different ways. There's what you see and what you practice. There's visual. Some people learn just listening. Others learn by doing. So, you know, usually it's good to combine all three. And it's always good to build upon prior knowledge. Like, for example, if the child lied and got caught, got punished, then you say it's not good to lie. The commandment says thou shalt not lie. Why? Because then you're going to suffer the consequences. And then if you lie, then you're going to have to build upon, you know, more lies. So it's better just to be honest. And the different ways to teach, especially when it comes to basic Christianity, because all children make mistakes, and you can use that as object lessons.
No, the child didn't make a mistake, though.
No.
The child turn up to your school, right?
Yeah, but even though you know, you've been a child yourself, and you know that's a process of growing up, so you can know from experience that child might have gotten punished, or that child might have, you know, been reprimanded, or that child might have done something they shouldn't do. Or some child did something to that child that they didn't like. So,
Craig, plug out the top, the cooktop for me, please. Thanks.
So, basic Christianity, I think it's a good place to start.
Yeah. So that's what you agreeing? That's how where you.
Yeah, I think I would.
Where you would start a basic Christianity?
I think I would. That's not to say to leave doctrines on the side.
All right, but it's part of basic Christianity doctrines.
Some of it is, sure, because
doctrines are not bad. Doctrines are teachings.
Nathan, for me, please. Just grab two batteries for me, please, that are charged. So, because you see, the question I'm asking goes back to, say, if I'm hitting that reset button. After all the experience that we've had, we've been in a regular church, we've been independent, whatever. Somebody comes to the door and you say, how am I going to help the person so that they don't go through all the, you know, how would I run my school that my students come up better, get a better grade, so to speak, and get a better education? What would be my process? Because basically, as I said, a church is a school. And
if you look at it, as I say, you can do, number one, I know righteousness. Righteousness would have to be taught, because righteousness is part of what's missing, whether it be a contemporary or a conservative church. What they don't talk about is righteousness. One is talking about you must follow the rule. One is talking about you need to praise the Lord. But what is absent is, okay, but what about cleaning the heart, doing right, being kind? They sidestep all of that discussion. So I know that would be part of the curriculum. We're going to have to talk about character. But still, that's me over here that's been in the war for years. So but the new coming, what do I teach them? Fresh off the boat, so to speak. What they need to understand for them to take up that process that you couldn't go 1, 2, 3, 4 up that logical step. Because remember, the true way to do it is you don't throw away the old just because you must throw it away, because we must be inventive. How do we build that, please?
One text that came to mind was 1 Corinthians 13, verses 2 and 3. When we talk about you understanding all prophecy and all mystery and all knowledge, but if you have not love, you could even remove a mountain. But if you have not love, though you bestowed your goods to feed the poor, right, and all these things, but you have not love, it profits you nothing. Right. And I see that what sometimes we have is when we think about love, we think about just holding somebody and just loving them. But as how I look at love is different. Is am I loving to my neighbor? Am I kind? Am I a brawler? Am I someone who can just sit down and listen, and willing to listen, and willing to learn? And these things that sometimes we have to teach somebody when they come in, is that the things that you used to do are things that you know, you look at as society and say, oh, these are good attributes. You know, there's a lot of things that people would have to unlearn.
Right.
Because, you know, the way that they do business in the world. If someone joined the church, you can't live that lifestyle anymore. Okay. See, I think that's something that when look at 1 Corinthians 13, you could teach someone a prophecy, but a person just as nasty as ever.
It still doesn't work.
It doesn't work.
No matter what you do, because they still have not focused on what is the number one thing you need, please.
Just with piggybacking on Brother Green's last comment about you could teach them prophecy and they could still just be as nasty as ever. The thought I was thinking is that in the same way that you can't teach a young student how to write a paper without first teaching them the alphabet and simple phonics, is the same way I don't truly believe you can teach someone doctrine without them first learning to be a basic Christian.
Okay.
Because if you teach someone basic Christianity first, that's the part of Christianity that deals with people's character.
That's right.
And one of the biggest things that people have the most trouble with is learning to be humble. And if you can't humble yourself, you could learn doctrine. You can learn that this sign means this, and this symbol means this, and these days add up to 2300, and this means that. But if you don't teach someone basic Christianity first, then all you've done is just educated a prideful person. Because then what happens is someone thinks that because they know the 2300-day prophecy, or because they know what the three scores or 606, that suddenly they've reached the pinnacle of Christianity, and meanwhile they never worked on the basic thing, which was to humble themselves and be kind and be courteous and have the Christian virtues that we read not only in the Bible, but even the contemporary prophet Sister White had to write over and over and over again in testimonies to the church and so many different books, because people knew prophecy but they didn't know how to be nice.
Right, so now when you think about that, right? If you think about Romans chapter 1, which was the next text, right? I don't know if you had your hand up, you were just smiling. You're pleased about what was said. Romans, if you look at Romans chapter 1 in verse 18, the point that was put in there is that they hold the truth in unrighteousness. Now, if you're told what the problem, how the problem keeps repeating itself, is not telling you how to try to avoid the problem repeating itself. Because we are told that, said, this is how the problem comes about. The Pharisees did this. They hold the truth while doing unrighteousness. The Catholic Church, they hold the truth while doing unrighteousness. Now we have the Protestants of America, as Ellen G. White talks about in Book Great Controversy. They hold the truth. Now it's 100 and something years now. So we have, this is prophecy fulfilled. They hold the truth in unrighteousness. So the whole idea is that, and after a while they don't, because later on it says they lost all truth. Because even as they did not, in verse 28, they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. God gave them over to a reprobate mind. Do they have the truth anymore? Nope. To do those things which are what? Not convenient. So you hold the truth in unrighteousness to a point where you lose the truth because of unrighteousness. No, you don't have the truth anymore. So this person or that, or these people or whatever have the truth, we have had thousands of years of history to show that it don't work. And so if I'm going to start out, I'm going to start here. Because if you can't get past this, we're wasting our time. Because you're going to end up over here anyhow. Because all you're going to do is a person who think salvation is basically okay. You think it's okay to hold the truth in unrighteousness. And that's a mark, and really we're going to excuse unrighteousness, but we're going to say the person have truth. But ultimately we know, and we have seen it with everybody, after a while they lose the truth. Because there's a famous statement of Energy White says that if you only pray but never work, you will cease to pray. Right? You will cease to pray. But it's the same thing. If you only doctrine or study or whatever, but you never do the words of God, you will cease to do the words of God and cease to even preach the word of God. And we can see how many people after a while they go quiet. Because what happened? It is not something that is promoted. It's a doctrinal religion or a creed religion. Now, on the board here, I had these quick ideas here, which is, it says to me, when I look at a contemporary worship service or an orthodox worship service, two of them can be boring, really, right? Because if you have ever heard, I remember a few years back, kept on hearing about this guy called Joel Osteen. I said, you know what, let me go on YouTube and watch. And I watched a few videos of him. And after about the third video, every single video after that, I knew what his sermons was going to be about. It's cookie cutter. You can't just know he's going to talk about the Lord's going to bless you. Yes, you're going to die tomorrow, but today I'm telling you, tomorrow is your best day. Your best day is ahead of you. And your best day is ahead of you always, no matter what's going on. It's so unrealistic and stuff like that, but it sounds good. Superficial. Easily become irrelevant because it had nothing to do with anything. The relevance is based upon self-importance. You see, to me, somebody who's relevant is not somebody who threw a ball in a hoop. But does the society think the person is relevant? Right? To me, relevance is a person that's doing things to save life, to protect people, to build things. That's relevant because their work is tangible. But irrelevance normally is something where somebody hype themselves. And you look at a lot of people, they're famous because they made themselves famous. Because they do some irrelevant thing that caused themselves to be famous, and they're very famous for being irrelevant. That makes sense, right? So easily become irrelevant because there's a certain point where you fall out of favor. How much years you give Joel Osteen before he fall out of favor? Another 5-10 years? When plastic surgery can't fix that anymore? You don't look pretty, you know what I'm saying? You don't look pretty again. And so after a while, you know, beauty is fleeting. So you become irrelevant, and then only the old people follow you. You know something is still in the business. What's his name? Jimmy Swagger. A lot of old people will follow him until they go to the grave with him. And then somebody fresh come along, a fresh, pretty face. But you think about the Bible, the men in the Bible, didn't even hit their peak until they were older. You see, the age didn't really matter. It was the content of what they were doing. Not so much, oh, I'm young and relevant, and that's what make me hot. You know, I'm a hot commodity because I'm hot, right? I'm hot because the message I'm preaching, but they're hot, you know, and that's to me is when they read Moses. Moses was not hot because he looked hot. Well, I don't know if he looked hot,
But I'm sure nobody was following because he was hot, you know. But this is normally what it is. And when you, God, as I say, you're pretentious, ostentatious. Do people follow that? I remember one time I was at somebody's house and I saw this TBS or something. Trinity Broadcasting. TBN? Trinity Broadcasting Network. And I saw this lady with her hair up to here, gold. It's like, I'm telling you, it's like at least, it's a good, I don't know how her hair got that high. I'm thinking it must be like they put a dead animal stuff in there or something. Or something they put up in there to keep it up there. And it just, and I'm like, I think I would just watch it just to sit and just look and thinking, that can't be a human being. That must be a special human being. Don't you think some of these people are special? Like, this really special, because it's just ostentatious that you would watch, because like, if you saw a clown walking on the street in full garb right now, just walking on the street, wouldn't you stop and look? You wouldn't? No, it's not because it's out of place. You're thinking there's no circus around here. Why is the circus? Where is? I would call it police because you know he's about to kill some people. It's a mass murder. You know, because it's out of place. It's just, and you know, I remember I was at a church in New Jersey here, not far from here, about 20 minutes away. And I was going to the church and my sister came and visited me. And this pastor was preaching and, you know, that's how he preached. And my sister said, he belong in a big city church in New York. You know, that don't work in the country. Because it seemed out of place. You seem like you're like somebody want to pinch him and tell him, there's only 20-something people in the church. Half of them are old. Half of them are old. You're probably blowing the ear in the ear. Like, pow! So I'm like, it seemed like it's out of place. You know what I'm saying? It's out of place. Because it makes no sense, but that's where you fake. It's like, because the process is, you need to, yeah, in a big church where there's 300-400 people, it might seem whatever, because there's all these people with the crazy hats and the crazy sequence and all that, it might seem like in place. But you come to a, you can imagine Jesus on the Mount of Olives preaching like that. It wouldn't make no sense. People be like, relax. Calm down, you're in the bush. There's no show here, right? John in the wilderness preaching like that, it wouldn't make no sense. But, you know, think about it, John in Wilderness, so you switch it out and take John and put him at Lakewood or Willow Creek or one of these churches, and then put them in the wilderness preaching. People come in there, it's hot, whatever there, and they're like, how are they everybody? You know, I can't do access, praise the Lord. Gaudy, pretentious, ostentatious, and it doesn't fit with reality. Because if you think about something about the Pope dress, right? If the Pope dressed that way, I was walking downtown any street. People would think, is he crazy? Like, why is he looking like that? It don't make no sense. You know what I'm saying? And that's what the problem with a lot of this stuff. It don't make no sense. So that's what I'm saying. If I'm doing church, I've obviously, how do you do it? Because then it still don't make no sense to me for the flip of it, for a person to come to church. Because I had a picture, I'm going to show you the picture, where you're coming short. See, I didn't use this picture this morning, but go ahead, Brother Green. Yeah, talk. You know, talk to us here.
A few years ago, I remember listening to an health speaker, and he's saying that, you know, if someone go in the street and start acting as of some of these, because he used a pastor, I'm not going to use the pastor's name.
Yeah, right.
But start acting how the pastors act in the church, will call the police or will call someone to have them check if they have a psychiatric problem.
Yeah.
But if you take him and put him in that church, he's like, okay.
Oh, it's worship. It's okay. And you think, oh, they're following Jesus. They're doing just like Jesus. I saw a guy do head banging on a pulpit one day. You see the video with the guy doing head banging? He started banging his head like this. He wasn't banging the pulpit. He was just going head banging. You know, they go back and forth. So much that the stuff on the Bible on the pulpit fell off. he even fall over. I mean, the level. And I'm thinking, and the music is going, and you're thinking, he's following Jesus. Now, you look at this, right? I wanted to use this one, but I couldn't find the copyright on it, so I wasn't sure. But so I'm using it now. So this is literally a Sunday. I'm not saying, because I think this is happening in Adventism. Before I say anything, just to make sure I'm balanced, I'm equal opportunity offender. There's an Adventist church in the afternoon. They were having a baptism, and somebody came in their bikini and got baptized by the pastor. So this is what's happening. So just imagine in a bikini getting baptized. I think that baptism probably was packed. So when you think about that, right? So this is Sunday worship, right? This is midday, like, you know, main worship. This guy, you see, he's in a, like, a khaki jeans and whatever. And I can show you worse. I can show you videos worse. No, you see him. You could have changed out the background. She probably would have to put on some pants and she some pants. I don't even, like, this is just a secular concert. Right?
I'm reading a comment from an online viewer.
Online viewer. God bless you, online viewer.
The problem with Joel Osteen and the other young ones is that they are so commercialized and preach a feel-good sermon. How many sermons are Bible-based?
Yeah, what is it?
How many sermons are Bible-based?
What's that word, how many?
How many?
Oh, they're saying their sermons are not, or they ask a question.
They're making the comment.
Oh, they're
asking rhetorically.
Oh, rhetorically, sorry. Yeah, it's not Bible-based. Because because people think that they're not preaching doctrines, and, you know, like they would say, this is what it is when you're in the mainland. The mainland is safe, right? And then people in the outside the mainland, like in the independent or the cowboy and western part of the church is not safe. But you think about it, Joel Osteen has doctrines. It's just you have to understand his doctrine. His doctrine is that you're going to be fine. To me, one of his number one doctrines, today, tomorrow is your better days are ahead of you. Better days are ahead of you. And that's his doctrine. But people don't get it. His doctrine is he really believes that your better days are ahead of you. And he's in Texas, where the people, their better days are not ahead of them. This is disaster central. Most of the disasters in America is happening in that place. So when I saw last year, when they were saying there's a Hurricane Harvey, so I said, in Houston, right? I said, what is in Houston? I'm really thinking about it, like, what is in Houston? I know something is in Houston that is important for me to know. Is that the bell's going off in my head, but it's not clicking until they made the news. And I said, oh, yeah, Joel Osteen, his church is in Houston. Because he said in all of Houston that your better days are ahead of you. And then here comes the hurricane. And guess what happened? For many of us in life, think about the children of Israel. Joel Osteen preached to them every Sabbath. Children of Israel, as you're going around the wilderness for 40 years, your better days are ahead of you. Boof. Then next Sabbath. Children of Israel, your better days are ahead of you. Broof. More dead bodies. As they drop in, don't listen to Moses. Your better days are ahead of you. Don't repent. Broof. That's all was happening. Their better days were not ahead of you. But if you listen to Joel Osteen, don't repent your sin because your better days are ahead of you. Broof. Anyhow, take it away. But it's unreal.
One more comment from online viewer. The older evangelicals are just as bad. They're expounding their own interpretation of the Bible.
The older evangelicals. Let me tell you. You've been seeing what's going on in the Christian media? Some Christian professors and stuff are calling for the federal government to step in and take over investigation of these churches. And to cut the wall that separate, because they're saying there are billions of dollars being stolen every year. And when you see the pictures of the people who have been accused and they believe are stolen money, it's all the older evangelical leaders. So the person is right there. It is unreal. And when you listen to what they're teaching, most people, as I say, I've listened to Adventist evil scholars, don't believe that they're teaching doctrines. They're teaching the cross of Christ. But there's a doctrine, they're not listening to a doctrine. I remember the one that died in Bahamas. He was teaching that the kingdom message, that Christ did not come to preach that we must take up our cross or something like that. He said, Christ tell you that you need to gain the kingdom. So he was saying you need to win the kingdom. So you need to go get a jet, your private jet. You need to get your big mansion. You need to get, because that's, we're supposed to be winning the kingdom. We're supposed to take over this kingdom for Jesus. You see, it's a doctrine. But he might sound pretty, but you need to listen to what he's saying, because he's telling you something and he's going to get you to a specific place. And so that's the problem with it. And I say really quickly here, so they're teaching doctrine and they're teaching things that are Bible-based, but you're not hearing what they're teaching. And notice that they're straighter than that. They have false litmus tests and false test doctrine. And this, especially that last one where I said they have false test doctrines, is not just in the First Day Church, it's in the Adventist Church. And in a lot of independent even groups in Adventists, they'll come along and say, you must believe in this doctrine because it is a salvation issue. But it's not a salvation issue, but they make it out to be that if you don't answer this to this thing and accept it, you're not going to be saved. So it's a false litmus test. But at the end of the day, they're all irrelevant, superficial, because you know if those churches close, the people will not do worse, they'll do better. Because if you have somebody in your ears every day telling you, your best days ahead of you, and you're sick, and you don't know that says there's a heart that's coming your way, you better get up and get on the treadmill. And he said, no, don't worry about that. The best days are ahead of you. Think about that. This is what he's telling the people every single day. And he has a whole bunch of people deceived into thinking that their best days are ahead of them. And the sad reality, we know so many people, guess what happened? Their best days are not ahead of them. You know, like the Lord says, to thou fool, today, your soul is required of you. This morning you need to go repent, because today, later in the day, you're going to die. Best days are not ahead of you. There's so many people right now that they're going to die today of a drug overdose. You're going to tell them that their best days are ahead of them? Their best days are not ahead of them. The only way that the best days are ahead of them is that the message of repentance have to be preached. That's how you're going to turn the curse. There's people that, as I say, their best days are ahead of them. And I think a lot of people are under that delusion. Think about how many people right now that in their mind they're not going to make the call election sure, because they're thinking they still have time, right? How many people that are not going to settle up their houses and their finances because they think, you know, they have forever. I don't have forever. I don't even know what's going to happen at any given moment. All I know is as I have today. And my best days, hopefully, is ahead of me, but probably they're not. And if they're not, you know, so is life. You know how many people today that they're going to have a loved one die? And they're going to suffer the rest of their life because of that. And you're telling the people the best days are ahead of them. Look at the tragedy. I was thinking how many people that go to that mass shooting last year or the year before in Las Vegas. Last year, it seemed like it's so long ago. The best days were not ahead of them. But if you keep telling people that, you're giving them whatever. But it seemed like, oh, we're having fun. We're singing and we're having fun. But you're being deluded. And that's why they're so dangerous. But on the flip side of that, guess who is deluding the people? The orthodoxy also. Because it seems so much solemn and reverent. Because people say, I like it when the church is so reverent and so orthodox. But it's fake because there's no true reverence, right? But I like it when the church is singing or whatever and irreverent, but it's fake also because there's no true love. Because don't people say, but look at that, they move like they have love. Yeah, they move like they have love, but they don't have no love. And I'll close off with this thought. Did you notice recently that Bill Hybel ran into trouble? And if they're not running into trouble with problems that they're causing, immorality problems. Notice the young man over there in the megachurch, pastor, covered him on the radio. I talk about him on the radio. He was 30. He killed himself recently, right? And then the other one over by California, what's his name? That's over by the other church over there. That he's a famous pastor. His son killed himself right in the house. So all that is going on is mayhem going on around them. All kind of investigation, all kind of accusation. It's a mess going on because nobody talking about repentance, confession, forgiveness, you know, righteousness. All they're talking about is just praise the Lord and we're here to worship. And the more they talk about that, they're not dealing with the problems of the people. and they're not helping the people, so the people are breaking out and doing all kind of craziness, but then it's happening in their own homes. And if he's not doing that, then people coming out of the closet or getting exposed. And these are the things happening because guess what happened? You're not teaching it, and you're acting as if we're good. We celebrating because we already safe. And the problem is you're celebrating something that you don't have. And that's where the problem is. To me, as our Christ says, if your name is in the book, that's what we need to celebrate. So, and I'll say this, there was a statement that I was thinking to use because I'm going to use it in the future for a study. There was a statement that I mentioned we were in communication via text, and Ellen G. White talks about this idea that the more wicked people are, the more gaudy they are, more ostentatious, the more proud they are. And if you look at this, it's not just in the secular world, because now we'll see a person who's like a homosexual and stuff like that. They're like flamboyant, but guess who's highest rates of suicide in the country amongst any group? It's people who are homosexual and transsexual and all that. But they, oh, and in public, they're like, oh, I'm happy. But it's fake happy. It's depressed. But in the church, it's the same thing. You think about it, they call the church, oh, praise the Lord is good. And these are the people who are the saddest people that you ever met. And over the years, for the people, many people that we've come and gone and worshiped and stuff like that, they're very depressed. But when they get going and the high kicking, you're like, man, righteousness exalt. Right? You're like, wow, man, I need some of that spirit. And then you start to realize, oh, fake. Fake, the person's about to kill himself talking about righteousness. As a matter of fact, who read it today? Sister Martha? Yeah, you read it today. Praise the Lord for that reading. I wanted to comment on that. I forget, it just came back to my mind. Right? You need to be encouraged if you follow Jesus. So you follow Jesus, you're not encouraged. Think Jesus was all depressed and wanted to jump off a building? That's not Jesus. I mean, your religion is not right. And you was he just one moment, hi, hi as a kite, and the next moment, whoosh. No, he wasn't. Like Christ wasn't, get excited. If Christ had a good day, it's a normal day. If a bad day, it's a normal day. Tell me what's new. Amen? So we sing to close. I pray, I may bless you this week. And truly that, we really stay from those extremes, because in our personal life, we can't leave those that Jekyll and Hyde extreme where, in public we're one way, in private we're another way. And that's not so. We go, we do the fake piety where we holy, but it's all kind of madness going on in our life. Or we do this kind of fake kind of praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Everything, let the Spirit lead, and no, Spirit never lead us, because the Spirit never lead us to do anything righteous. Spirit never, think about it. I remember, we were talking about recently somebody that we knew. Every time it was, whatever the Spirit says. All right, let the Spirit lead. Let the Spirit lead. And you said, why did the Spirit never lead you to do right and to be nice and to everything? The Spirit make people friendly. Spirit not going to make people depressed. Spirit not going to lead you to always fighting with your husband. Spirit not going to lead you to beating your wife. Eh? But the Spirit never leads them for that. The Spirit only leads them when you tell them something and don't want to do it. Let me pray about it. Yeah, well, you don't pray about other things, but this is the only thing you want to pray about when I suggest something to you, right? Oh, I want to consult with God. You never consult with God before, but all of a sudden you want to consult with God. Oh, your life is so wicked. I'll tell this last one. I remember this person I was dealing with, and, I tell them, look, you need to do such and such and such, and they say, oh, no, they're not listening to me. They went ahead and do something different. So they call me back again and say, oh, the Lord is leading them. Now the Lord is leading them. So I said, well, did the Lord lead you the first time? Because the result was a massive failure and just destruction and combobulation. And call me one day, oh, they're trying to rape me and stuff like that. I was like, oh, yeah, they were trying to rape you. So let me ask you this. Did the Lord lead you in that position? Oh, no, the Lord didn't lead me in that position. I said, the Lord would never lead you in that position, right? How do you get in that position? So then we have to start off now by talking first about how do you get in that position? Because you use the Lord to get yourself in that position. And you're telling me that the Lord led you in this position? So now, when I'm talking to you now, you're going to have to listen to me. Because the first time I'm talking to you, you told me that I'm wrong because the Lord led you in a different direction. And the Lord lead, and you tell me now, the Lord, oh no, 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 no. No, no, the Lord didn't lead me in the first time. Right? The Lord didn't lead me the first time. I said, okay, no, we can't talk. Because confession is good for the soul, right? your flesh lead you the first time, and that's what got you in the position. Because the Lord not going to lead you to be fornicating with people outside of the church and not getting married. I'm telling you, you need to settle up that business. Oh, no, you're not going to settle up because the Lord. Lord never going to lead you to that type of lifestyle. Jesus doesn't lead people into sinning. Amen? Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Let's sing to close. Lord is good. Lord is good.
Let us take up our hymnals and turn to number 309. Hymn number 309. Okay, hymn 309. Do we all have it? Okay, very good.
I invite all who are watching and all here to join us for prayer at this time. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear Lord, for this wonderful time that you have created for us, time aside from the rest of the week, for us to commune together with you and be with like-minded brethren and also have an opportunity to somehow communicate with others through live stream. We're grateful for these things, dear Heavenly Father, and we ask only that we may continue to contemplate on the wonderful words that you have spoken to us today, and how much you have opened our eyes, not only today, but throughout our life. And we thank you, dear Lord, for this opportunity to be Christians. It really is a privilege, and we're grateful for that. We ask, dear Heavenly Father, that we may continue to grow in a spiritual sense, dear Lord. And we ask, dear Heavenly Father, also that those that are listening or watching, that they may be blessed with that word. At this time, dear Lord, we ask for traveling mercies for those that are going home. And we pray, dear Heavenly Father, for our brethren out in different parts of this country, in Washington, Detroit, Florida, Chicago, different cities. And we pray, dear Heavenly Father, that again, that they may continue to press forward and study thy word and continue to be faithful in all the things that they do pertaining to heaven. We pray at this time, dear Heavenly Father, that you may bless continually, dear Lord, with us in wisdom and in strength of character. And we're grateful, dear Lord, for these precious gifts of from heaven that no money can buy. At this time, we would like to pray these blessings, dear Lord, on behalf of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior and our Redeemer. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Join us next week as we continue to study Sabbath school sermon and have a Bible study or devotion in the afternoon. At this time, I would like to just say have a good night, and hopefully we'll see you soon. Bye.